to start with this photo, which is a photo of my home. It's where my parents were born, my grandparents were born. My grandfather, after whom I was named, he was also Dr. Kenneth Tupper. He was a preeminent Canadian scientist. He was the vice president of the National Research Council of Canada. He was the dean of engineering at the University of Toronto. He actually purchased the first computer for the University of Toronto in the 1950s. My father kind of followed in his footsteps, also taught at a post-secondary institution in technology, taught photogrammetry. And so I was raised to be a scientist. And for my childhood and early teens, thought, you know, that was the royal road to truth. That pretty much most of the issues have been solved. You know, there's a few loose ends to tie up, but science was definitely going to get us there. And then in my mid-teens, I had some experiences that I'm sure most of you can relate to that challenged my belief that science had all of the ways of knowing that were valuable in the world. And that really sort of opened my mind. I went on and studied philosophy because I thought, you know, there's no more urgent questions to study than those in epistemology and ontology and metaphysics. And became interested in, you know, explaining what experiences I'd gone through and how, why they weren't valued more in our culture. I began to do some reading, learned that there was a long tradition within the Judeo-Christian tradition, the fruit of the tree of knowledge talked about in the Old Testament, perhaps an entheogenic allegory, fruit that gave one knowledge of the gods, the use of soma in the Indo-Aryan cultures, the use of kaikion or some kind of entheogenic substance in the Eleusinian mysteries of ancient Greece. But then there was a long period of alienation from states of consciousness like these for 1,500 years, other than alcohol intoxication. And of course, the repression by religious and ecclesiastical authorities in the form of burning witches and, of course, indigenous traditions. The more I learned about some of those indigenous traditions, however, the more interested I became in the metaphor of plant teachers that I kept coming across. When I was thinking of going to graduate school, having done some teaching, thinking I would do it in education, but I'd really be interested in pursuing a thesis on the educational value of psychedelic plants and chemicals, and try to unpack this metaphor of plant teachers. And of course, I knew about the claims in the 1960s of creativity and cognitive enhancement and mind expansion. Part of what I started to explore when I began this is the alienation from experiences of wonder and awe, which began in the 18th century with the rise of the Enlightenment. I recommend this book by Lorraine Daston and Catherine Park called Wonders in the Order of Nature. They talked about how with the rise of the scientific enlightenment, so wonder became kind of vulgar. And so this quote, wonder, natural philosophy, and then natural philosophy was the term that was used for science at that time. So science wasn't really what we understand it today. Wonder and natural philosophy smacked at the disruptive forces of enthusiasm, superstition, and religion and politics. Thus central to the new secular meaning of enlightenment as a state of mind and a way of life was the rejection of the marvelous. And this is a tragedy in some ways, as wonder and awe are vital emotions for the human experience, for optimal education and development, for finding meaning and purpose in life. But in many ways, they're counter to modern values of efficiency, profitability, or technical rationality. Maybe either a symptom or a cause of what Weber called the disenchantment of modernity. We've seen a kind of move to re-enchantment through things like television, video games, malls, theme parks, etc. And schools have been part of that systematic repression of wonder and awe. Public schooling, of course, is a very new institution. It's only around 150 years old in the way that we know it. Privilege is reason and rationality and almost an ideology of what's known as scientism. Every scientist in some ways have forgotten unorthodox approaches to knowing that their forebears in the early modern period brought. And so wonder and awe are not cultivated in schools in a way that might be valuable, particularly through things like the architecture, the regimen, the discipline. Now we see medications where kids who are displaying certain kinds of characteristics are medicated to make them more normal. I drew on the work of one of my professors, Kieran Egan, who wrote a great book called The Educated Mind. He talked about the conflicted aims of schooling, arguing that schools are trying to do several things at once and does none of them very effectively. On the one hand, they're trying to socialize, you know, get young people to grow up and be factory workers and have 2.3 kids and the white picket fence. On the other hand, they've got this ambition of platonic truth-seeking coming out of ancient Greece, but obviously that's kind of in conflict with the socialization element. There's the self-actualization coming out of Jean-Jacques Rousseau and the idea of, you know, allowing the organic child to flourish and find themselves, but also kind of in conflict with the first two. I would also add to this the public health function that's been further embedded in schools. So Kieran Egan asks if there's perhaps another way to conceive of what it means to be educated. And he drew on the ideas of a Soviet psychologist named Lev Vygotsky, who developed what's known as cultural historical school of philosophy and the extended theory of mind. Vygotsky is really an advocate of understanding how cognitive tools are important in our development as individuals and as cultures. So for Vygotsky, the primordial cognitive tools were literacy and numeracy, but then other examples were maps, mnemonic techniques, scientific instruments, things like abacuses, and of course now computers. My question or query in my work was perhaps could we think of psychoactive substances as cognitive tools, particularly psychedelics, and could that metaphor be helpful in framing the way we think about these things and the potential risks or benefits, understanding them as tools. Egan weighs in, if you want to check out his book, he talks about thinking of a fully educated person as having five types of understanding that he sees as developmental in human culture through pre-civilization, through early civilization, and into the modern period. Somatic understanding is pre-linguistics or rooted in the body. The mythic understanding is related to orality and the poetic or narrative storytelling function of traditional cultures. The romantic understanding was tied up with literacy and where we started to look at limits or extremes of experience. Philosophic understanding, development of science and looking for patterns, principles, and theories. And then in our sort of postmodern age, the ironic understanding, the collapse of meta-narratives. So he suggested that, as we move through these types of understanding, often we kind of forget the earlier ones and focus on the more recent ones. But suggesting that to be fully educated, we'd be sort of have facility in all of these types of understandings and deploy the appropriate tools for those understanding. I wanted to focus on particularly the somatic and the mythic types of understanding that I thought were kind of missing in our contemporary educational systems. And that perhaps, again, the psychedelics or plant teachers could be these kinds of cognitive tools to develop these ways of thinking. In addition to Kieran Egan's work, I looked at Howard Gardner's theory of multiple intelligences, wrote a book called Frames of Mind, critiquing the mainstream understanding of intelligence, the IQ test, as focused largely on two types of intelligence, logical, mathematical, and linguistic intelligence. He thought there was at least five additional ones, spatial intelligence, musical intelligence, kinesthetic, interpersonal, and interpersonal. This is quite influential in some educational circles. People began to approach him and ask, are there only seven? Could there be other types of intelligence? So in 1999, he updated his thinking on this, suggesting that perhaps there's a naturalist intelligence. And he said, in traditional cultures, it would be sort of knowing all of the different types of plants or animals in your environment, being able to categorize them well. In the contemporary world, it might be knowing cars. Those people know makes and models of all different types of cars. So they've got this sort of way of understanding the world. And he said people approached him about a spiritual intelligence, and he wasn't willing to go there, but he entertained the idea of an existential intelligence. He joked about having perhaps there's 8.5 intelligences. He wasn't willing to commit to the existential intelligence. He had a set of criteria, which I won't go through here, but he said, he met some of them. Here's his definition of it. It involves having a heightened capacity to appreciate and attend to the cosmological enigmas that define the human condition, an exceptional awareness of the metaphysical, ontological, and epistemological mysteries that have been a perennial concern for people of all cultures. I took his criteria for what constitutes an intelligence and said, if we can conceive of psychoactive, psychedelic, and entheogenic substances as cognitive tools, perhaps we can better appreciate how they validate the idea of an existential intelligence. And sort of explored this in a paper that was ultimately published in the Canadian Journal of Education, which is fairly conservative education journal, so I was pleased to have that accepted. This idea wasn't mine originally. I first sort of came across this actually reading books in my teens. Aldous Huxley's book Island was a big sort of game changer in my thinking about the world. In 1953, he wrote, "Under the current dispensation, the vast majority of individuals lose, in the course of education, all the openness to inspiration, all the capacity to be aware of other things than those enumerated in the Sears Roebuck catalog, which constitutes the conventionally real world. Is it too much to hope that a system of education may someday be devised which will give results in terms of human development commensurate with the time, money, energy, and devotion expended? In such a system of education, it may be that mescaline or some other chemical substance may play a part in making it possible for young people to taste and see what they of him at second hand in the writings of the religious or the works of poets, painters, and musicians. What he's describing here is again becoming facile in the area of existential intelligence. And of course, the latest neuroscience research is now corroborating some of these speculations. The work of Catherine McLean and her colleagues at Johns Hopkins, that psilocybin has been associated with increased openness, it's one of the big five personality traits, and then more recently with LSD, openness and optimism found to be enhanced in Robert Harris's lab. Ayahuasca has been associated with increased mindfulness capacity and with divergent thinking and creativity. Other research on population-level data on psychedelics that are used in non-medical settings have been associated with reduced suicidality, reduced recidivism, and reduced intimate partner violence. There's more and more scientific evidence coming from various avenues to point us in the direction of thinking beyond the healing function, which, of course, is tremendously valuable, but it may be that there's an even greater value in the non-medical or non-therapeutic benefits of these substances used, I think, in carefully controlled contexts where, I think, looking again at traditional indigenous cultural practices as the model, if these are tools that have real power, then we need to respect those tools. A knife in the hands of a skilled chef or a master chef or a skilled surgeon can do miracles, but a knife in the hands of a child who thinks it's a toy can be potentially dangerous. Looking again at the traditional indigenous ritual practices, ritual is a set of order, repetition behavior, collective symbolic action. It's a primordial social activity, often involving intergenerational education. Some elders model responsible use. It's a form of liminal experience, often a rite of passage, something I think that's lacking in contemporary modern culture. Ritual itself is a form of proto-harm reduction for psychoactive substance use, a safe container that minimizes potential risks and maximizes potential benefits. More research is needed. We need healthy human subject clinical studies of both therapeutic and non-therapeutic. Population data set analysis, like the work that Peter Hendricks has done and other colleagues, I'm sure there's a lot more that could be done looking at associations with psychedelic use and other types of behaviors or health outcomes. Microdosing, obviously, is a popular topic these days. It would be great to see some solid research to explore where that might take us. And then just do more work on traditional indigenous knowledge practices. In terms of education, public education, so that's school-based, mass media, alternative media, conferences like this are a great opportunity for helping people understand the potential benefits of these substances, because most people are only schooled in the harms that they've heard about for decades. And this includes, of course, professional education. I work with a lot of physicians, and I find often they're the group that are most ignorant about the history of psychedelics and contemporary research on psychedelics. So there's a lot of work to be done in various professional groups, doctors, nurses, social workers, teachers, to help them understand the history of their own profession in some cases. A lot don't know that LSD was once a promising psychiatric medication that had real positive health outcomes for treating things like alcoholism or certain kinds of mental illnesses. The harm reduction project psychedelic emergency response is going to be important because people will continue to use these things in less controlled settings. Drug checking or testing samples of drugs. Canada recently, there was a blotter paper discovered with, this was a seizure by police, blotter paper discovered with carfentanil, which is an analog of fentanyl, which is itself an analog of heroin, or a much more potent form. Carfentanil is used essentially in veterinary medicine for sedating elephants, but very, very, very potent opioid that can kill people in tiny amounts. And so to find it on blotter paper is very disturbing. The user forums where people can share knowledge, so places such as, or sites such as Arrowhead and Blue Light. And again, the symposia group and other destigmatization or coming out efforts to further sort of legitimize and destigmatize people who use these substances. In terms of public policy, looking at indigenous rights, political, territorial, cultural rights of indigenous people, lobbying elected officials, influencing political party platforms, influencing professional organizations. If you are a professional, go and talk to your board or your college, educate them a little bit, print out some scientific articles, bring them along, share them. Engage health system leaders, funding agency officials, and other bureaucrats. There's lots of informal power structures that exist where these ideas can be shared and perhaps influenced. And then general social movement building. there's a lot of work to be done in looking where we can go from our currently failed war on drugs. This is a paper that recently co-authored and published with colleagues in British Columbia looking at a public health-based vision for the management and regulation of psychedelics. It's one vision, it's not necessarily the only or the best, it's one that we think holds a lot of water in terms of, again, potentially balancing risks and benefits. But certainly it's just a trial balloon to offer some ideas about where we might go. I'm sure there's some who would critique some of the ideas we put forward here, but I urge people to check it out, and if you don't like it, articulate your own vision, because we need lots of voices to come together to come up with ideas that are, as a collective, will be better than individuals. Because I work in education, and I'm interested in drug education, one of the big fears about this is mixed messages. The real mixed message is the cultural attitudes that we have that encourage young people to say yes to all of the instant gratifications, say yes to the Coca-Cola, Nike running shoes, burgers, but then expect them to say no to the sometimes real pleasures or insights that can come from the use of drugs. It's very sort of unrealistic or at odds with what they're hearing in a more dominant cultural narrative. And that addictions to things like money and debt, because money and debt are actually identical, and cheap petroleum energy are perhaps the biggest social issues. I refer to the work of one of my professors, Dr. Bruce Alexander, who wrote a great book called The Globalization of Addiction. If you're interested in exploring, how addictions are a much broader issue than just the narrow sort of drug addictions that we typically focus on. And the dislocation that we all face as denizens of the modern world. And then looking at traditional indigenous wisdom practices, and learning the idea that learning from plant teachers or other entheogens or psychedelics may be crucial in shifting our thinking in this regard. So my grandfather, Dr. Kenneth Tupper, told me when I was about 10 years old that there was a report written by a think tank in Europe called the Club of Rome, and the report was called The Limits to Growth. The report was published in 1972, that it was the most important thing that my generation was going to have to deal with. And it was widely criticized by economists and was sort of ignored, but it stuck with me. I certainly had a kind of ecological sensibility in much of my work, thinking about the potential value of these kinds of substances, entheogens, psychedelics. I want to bring us back to this photograph, which I grew up knowing, but my parents didn't, my grandparents didn't. This photograph was only taken after the launch of the space program. Before this image was released publicly by NASA, it was envisioned by a guy named Stuart Brand, one of the married pranksters, who has a story about sitting on a roof, having taken LSD, living on the rise, and buildings were not quite parallel. They were kind of orthogonal to the Earth. He thought he was perceiving the curvature of the Earth, and sort of imagined himself up on top of the building he was on and looking down over the building, and then higher up looking down over the neighborhood. This is in San Francisco. Then he's higher up looking over the whole Bay Area, and then even higher up looking over the west coast of the United States. He said he imagined himself going further and further and further until he imagined himself out in space looking back at this image. And he thought, I've never seen this image, but it must exist. This is like 1966 or so. So he started a button campaign saying, why haven't we seen a photo of the Earth from space yet? Sent it to congresspeople and went to rock festivals and gave it out. And it was within a year or so that NASA released this image for the first time publicly. And this image was so powerful. And I think it's a beautiful illustration of the potential value of these kinds of substances to have that kind of creative insight about something so crucial. And so I just sort of hope that's an inspirational type of story that can help us think about how these kinds of things might be integrated in the future and help us come to terms with the spaceship Earth that we need to be taken care of. So I'm going to leave it there, and we'll welcome any questions. I started my master's program in 1999, and I was lucky to find a couple of professors, including a professor of indigenous studies, who were supportive of what I was trying to do. There was nobody sort of expert in the area of entheogenic education. Actually, there was one person, Tom Roberts, at the University of Northern Illinois, I had corresponded with, and he was interested in education and psychedelics. But I ended up going to Simon Fraser University in my hometown, and so I did manage to find a committee that was willing to support me in pursuing this. That was supportive, but it definitely had lots of criticisms from others, colleagues or other students and some professors. Most often it was kind of amusement and sort of just not paying any attention to me. Not that much active antagonism. Fortunately, I was told it was career suicide, that I would never get a job. that, you know, if I wanted to pursue this maybe as a junior professor or a postdoc, but to do it as a master's thesis was a say career suicide. But my response to them was, well, I'm not here to get a job, actually I'm here because I've got an interest and a passion in something. Isn't that what graduate school is supposed to be about? So they didn't have much to say to that. Canadian Journal of Education, I met the editor a couple of years later at a conference, and he told me that it was the most controversial manuscript that they'd ever received. It was a huge debate among the editorial staff about whether to accept it for publication. It had some positive reviews and some very negative. I think one of the comments from one of the negatives was this was morally abhorrent to suggest that drugs could be educational. But they said they'd made a decision a year or two earlier to be taking on a bit more controversy and trying to sort of push the envelope. So they did accept in the end. So I was lucky, I guess, to be sort of in the right place at the right time to advance these ideas. For some individuals, drugs like Adderall or Ritalin are very helpful. My understanding is they're probably widely overprescribed. I question the etiology of attention deficit disorder. What is it about the modern condition that leads to attention deficit? So perhaps some of the technological things like lots of screens in our culture, perhaps there's other factors that are playing into this. It's not just a pure neurocognitive developmental issue. So I think that often it's masking symptoms of other types of broader social cultural issues. We use medications to dampen things down and make kids more normal and conform. And it'll help. Obviously, teachers are overburdened in the classroom, large classes of kids, so to keep them under control, it can be helpful to have them medicated. So I understand that there's other forces at work. So it's a complex issue, but I would say it's a challenge one we need to think about, perhaps other non-pharmaceutical alternatives to some of those issues. My own definition of success would be more than just legalization. It would be a massive socioeconomic transformation to create a system of social justice and economic justice globally, where economy and ecology are truly synonymous. Right now, there's as much relationship between ecology and economy as there is between astrology and astronomy today. Although I think we've got it backwards. We think economy is what's real and solid and quantifiable, and ecology is this kind of hippy-dippy, mumbo-jumbo thing. I would suggest that it's the other way around, and that if we're going to be at our own peril, learn that the hard way. So I think my utopian, I guess, roots would be that there's going to be a much bigger transformation than just ending the war on drugs, but it's going to be a much bigger systemic change. For sure, it was a political maneuver that I made to engage with the topic through the metaphor of plant teachers. And maybe it's more than, this is the challenge, and maybe it's more than just a metaphor, right? The ontology of drinking ayahuasca and encountering a sentient being, to have that phenomenologically, that experience, is very compelling, but then to try to share it with colleagues in the university department is a little, it was a step that I personally wasn't willing to take. I figured it was a little safer to go with something that was, material and something that they could maybe get their heads around. But I think, again, more work should be done in this area and looking, again, at the traditional indigenous knowledge practices and perhaps taking them more seriously. I certainly don't want to say that we have, what modern Western scientific culture has the final word on anything related to epistemology, and that we perhaps need to, again, take these kinds of things more seriously. And that if my shift to a cognitive tool frame can help us move back in the other direction, perhaps, then it'll be, I'll have made the right choice. Maybe it'll backfire, I don't know. Right now, it's something that I'm still committed to.